So yeah, so technically I don't work in Nijmegen yet, right? Only in November. So I am still the head of the information access group at CWI, but it will all change. So today I will talk about a topic that I started on when I joined Delft, where I met Jun Wang as a PhD student. And Jun was doing sort of things in multimedia. I gave Wang a lecture on how the language modeling approaches of IR work, and they might be applied to multimedia. And then Jun had the idea, oh, but that if it is that easy, then it should also work for recommendation systems. And we worked on that, and it led to a few papers, and one paper is highly cited, actually. I'll come back to that later. Although, I don't think many IR people cite it. This is the good thing of these crossover works is that you reach other fields. Right? And I'll try to, so what I try to convey is that we have these probabilistic basics of information retrieval, and we have studied that since the 60s, or the 50s really. And they apply to many, many cases. And sometimes in a different area, people come up with different approaches that could also have been cast using the models that we developed in the information retrieval field. And sometimes then you get even better results. And if you, at the end of the lecture, you will go home a little bit confused maybe, but also enthusiastic about going back to the old literature. And that's what I hope that you will do, because we don't take that time too much. And I think you should have read all these papers. A good starting point is Kerr Spark Jones' readings in IR. It's a bundle. And if you have read all of those, that will be very helpful, I think. All right, so let's start to do something real now. So what do I want to talk about? Well, I'll talk about recommendation systems, and I'll start. It might be a bit repetitive with some of the other lectures, but I think it's still good to go through the whole thing in detail. So we'll do a collaborative filtering. Then I'll talk a little bit about the language modeling approaches and explain in detail how you can use the same type of setup to do collaborative filtering. Then I will briefly go over approaches where we take advantage of ratings. We come back to that later. And I'll close with a lot of comments about the vector space model. So here I labeled it back to the future, because traditionally we started with the vector space model, and then people said, oh, we need to have better, not so ad hoc methods. But at the end of the talk, you will see that it's actually a question, is the vector space model so ad hoc? Is it so much more ad hoc than the probabilistic models? Well, that the goal is that you go home and you're thinking. So, what is recommendation? Well, if I get, so I've worked with some people who started to publish in ACM recommendation systems, and they get a bit angry if I say this. So, then you have those IR people and they just say it is searching without a query. But it's really the best way to describe it, I think. So you still want to deliver relevant information to the user, right? You just don't ask the user upfront to explicitly say what they are interested in. If you have that mode, you don't have the query, but you may need, you may be able to observe what the user does online. And then you can use that information that you learned about the user to provide information that is relevant to what they are doing. Okay. So, usually, the recommendation type researchers, they talk about three types of recommendation approaches. One is content-based, then you have collaborative filtering, and you have hybrid approaches. Now, content-based recommendation is really what we are usually what is the most close to information retrieval. You use the content of information objects to decide whether it's a good suggestion for a user or not. The other approach, collaborative filtering, I say a lot more about that that later. And actually, you all know about it, of course. But let's just go over it again. Maybe you learned something that you thought like, oh, is that how it really works? And then in collaborative filtering, you have memory-based and model-based approaches. Okay, the model-based are much more for the machine learning and interested people. But we will focus primarily on what they refer to as memory-based collaborative filtering systems. And I'll show at the end that you can use these model-based approaches. They're usually based on things like matrix factorization, and that then actually they don't improve the results. And now again, I have, so this is actually videoed, right? I'm saying all of this, and people in recommendation are now gonna say, oh, here is another example of an IR researcher. Anyways. We need to speak up every now and then because all the machine learning people say that IR is just applied machine learning, which is not true at all, of course. So here's an example of content-based recommendation. Actually, the part that I highlight is the on the right side is the perhaps best working approach for recommendation, just popularity based. So this is the screenshot of a newspaper that I read at home. It's a Dutch newspaper, and it's an article that is realistic that I would read it. It's about bands and music and venues where you can see bands. But then in the popularity-based panel here, you just have the other articles that at that time that I opened the web page are most read by others. And we have done in the group, we have done a few studies with content-based recommendation, because at the moment you can work with a German company, it's called Plista, and they provide something that is the open recommendation platform. And it's really cool. Because what they allow us as researchers to do is to actually hook in when I open this page to give what will happen is they send a request to your own server. And so I signed up for that, but everyone in the room can do that. So you can sign up for this open recommendation platform. And then you get requests and you get updates about major German newspapers like Der Spiegel and Frankfurter Allgemeine. And at the point that you get an invitation to provide recommendations, it can happen that they put your recommendations here, in this panel. But then on the Der Spiegel site, or on the Frankfurter Allgemeine site. And so actually your recommendations from your algorithm, what you are playing with, are being served to users. To the real users that are reading the newspaper. And you get reports back about the click-through rate that is achieved. You can take part at CLAY in it's one of the many CLAY tasks, and it's the one on news recommendation.
Social book search.
No, that's a different one. The social book search is not using the Plista platform, I think. Anyway, it's organized by Frank Hopfgartner. So the nice thing is you can put your own recommendations there and see what happens. And what we learned as a research group is that all our fancy algorithms are not really useful, because actually what is most useful is recent and popular. Yeah, that leads to the best click-through rate. And in the challenge at the Rexis conference, a workshop on news recommendation there, we had the best click-through rate of all the systems. But the only thing we did was show the most recent and most popular pages in the recommendation panel. So anyway, this is a bit of side discussion. So content-based is very easy. You use this as an information retrieval query on the database of other articles, and then you show the best ranking articles here. In this case, well, most of you won't speak Dutch, but the recommendations that came here are not so good. I don't know why, if you write something about a pop venue where you can see bands, that information about the Greek crisis is very important. And according to the algorithm that this newspaper uses, this is very closely related. It might be just the word Amsterdam or whatever that is in both documents. Not sure. Anyway, so this was not relevant anymore now because we already discussed it. But I wanted to emphasize that you have a mix of all this recommendation also every time when you're on social media, because the platform decides what you get to see from all the streams of all your friends. We don't really know how that is done. So I also wanted to give you a personal recommendation before we start the real lecture. I think if you are into any type of music, then you should listen to this artist. So. And it's not allowed. Sometimes I post clips on my Facebook and one of my PhD students said, "Warning, don't open this if you treasure your ears." But this is actually, everybody will like this. And it is, but what I wanted to highlight there is that in music, it's not so easy to do a content-based recommendation. Why not?
Because what words are meaning is in both songs.
Hey, it's not the other teachers. I was trying to catch student participation. You can just tweet it. So basically, content-based matching is really hard for music. Right? Although maybe Sien will say a little bit about it. I'm not sure. Maybe not music, right? But it's very hard to make sense of the relation between the signal in the music that you listen to and the signal in the music that might also be interesting for you to listen to. Unless you're into techno, then it's very easy. but this might just give away my age, this comment. So here you see related artists. So these related artists, they are usually produced with a technique called collaborative filtering. Now, I saw people start yawning. I hope this is not too obvious. So, collaborative filtering was first appearing in the literature under the name social information filtering, and highlighting the role of other people, so the social. And that was done by Patty Maas, who was then in Brussels. So, if you're in the Netherlands, then if there are successes in Belgium, you say, oh, this is also from the Benelux, right? Patty Maas moved to MIT and but she already very early on made a system called Ringo, after a famous musician, of course, that did collaborative filtering far before any commercial application. And it was cast in music. Now, what you do with collaborative filtering is that you ignore the content at all. The only thing you look at is what do users do with the content in the collection. And then, so you can ask users to explicitly rate content. So to say, like, I really like Natalie Praas. I just told you that, right? I gave it 5 stars and I said you should all listen to it. But if you have ratings on many of the items that might interest you, then you can look at other profiles, other users that have rated the same thing similarly. Right? That's actually the basic principle that all these techniques are based on. Now we find a user that's very similar. We hope the user is not exactly the same. Why not? Oh, this goes even better. So, okay, I'm not a professor yet. I don't have a lot of teaching experience. But if I do this in Delft, then I get somebody give an answer, especially if I'm quiet for 30 seconds.
What was the question again?
Did you not tweet the answer yet? Yeah. So we have the okay. Yeah. Maybe do that at home. So if you find an identical user profile, there's nothing to recommend. Why not?
Because they've done the same thing as you
probably. Exactly. There are no other songs. Now most of you probably didn't hear Natalie Press yet, although half a year ago, half a year ago, that was more true, I think, but let's assume most of you didn't hear that yet. So now if some of you have similar taste to my music profile, then I have something to recommend. Right? So you need similarity between the people, but then the only recommendation you can do come from the things that were not already in the same profiles. Okay. Don't worry if you don't get it fully yet, because I go over this for much longer now. But the leading principle is basically that people's tastes are not randomly distributed, not even for us academics. Right? We are not so special. There are always more people like you, and you behave more like unconsciously. You will try to behave more like some other people do, and we can exploit that in information systems, just like marketeers exploited that for ages. Even before they had computers to do that. Okay, so here's the canonical model, and I spent some more time on this, even though you might all know this by heart. But just so to make sure that if I say user, item, rating, yeah, that we all talk about the same thing. So this is the standard movie database example. So we have here the different users. Oh, I highlighted that nicely. And we have the different items. And in this case, the items are not songs, but they are movies. Right? And what we also see is that Dave gave 5 stars to this movie, Golden Eye. Right? So apparently, he liked watching it. This is the user profile for user Dave, right? So it basically has ratings for the items that he has seen and evaluated and made available for us. That's why you see this often in a social media setting. This is the item profile. That is for one particular item, all the ratings from all the different users. Now, the task for at least how it was, how the problem of collaborative filtering was formulated originally, was to predict the rating for one of the empty cells. So here we have Love Actually, movie, some rom-com, and we have this guy Boris, who, judging from the from his profile, watch his movie together with his girlfriend a lot. And then we need to say, will this person like Love Actually as well? And how many stars would he give that movie? Okay. Now, the a standard way to do it is, in this case, item-based, is that you just take the similarities between all these item profiles. You normalize that, multiplied with the ratings from, let's see, this is over the items from this user. And then you, so it's basically the average of all the stars that we had on this row. Oops. So what do we do? We want to know this one. We look at the similar item profiles, and then we try to. I have better explanation for that actually. Later slides. So, what are the benefits over the content-based approach? Well, we already said, okay, you might not have a good model of the content. For text, we pretty much know what to do, but for music and films, we don't. There are quite a few papers that go on about this notion of serendipity. It's based on some fairy tale from a princess. But the idea is basically, if you just go to the record store and you look in the boxes of what they have on sale, you might be suddenly triggered by a record that has a very beautiful cover. And it turns out you also like the music. But you would usually not have started to consider listening to that music at all, if you just listen to more of the same music that you had been listening to all the time. And the argument, and Patty Maas made a big deal about that in the beginning, the argument is that collaborative filtering as opposed to content-based methods has this inherent notion of serendipity. And of course it's brought in by all these other people that are doing things that are similar as you anyways. So the question is, how much serendipity do you get? Right? You get just serendipity between the little group of people that are similar enough. Okay. So the other thing is that it has an implicit mechanism for qualitative aspects like style. Now, what do we mean with that? So if you have a standard IR model and you manage to retrieve a book by Fitzgerald, right? Then the fact that Fitzgerald is a writer that wrote very beautiful English is not encoded in any of the models that we are using. So the only thing that you know is that you have a book about New York and people that are in the 20s and like jazz, and it's a bit tragic story. But how beautiful it is written is not encoded there. And that you can get from the judgments of the people. So it's some information that you can use that is not available in the content-based approaches. Or at least not in most of the content-based approaches. Some aspects of IR are starting to take this into account. So if you're interested in that, then look at the readability work by Kevin Collins Thompson. I think that is great work, and I think it's not exploited enough for retrieval. But now back to recommendation. So recommendation also has problems if your domain is too broad. It will not work. And if the group is very large, this causes computational problems and also some qualitative problems. So the quick example that I always give is, okay, I like a certain type of music, and that is captured well by most collaborative filtering approaches. So if you follow these music sites or you use Spotify, I get reasonable recommendations. But if the recommendation profiles would include many other things as well, like what television programs you watch or what books you read, then it starts to break down. Why is that? Because, well, there are a lot of people that watch soccer every night, and then their contribution to the similarity of the profile becomes too strong, And then you get in the wrong music, because the similarity was just based on the fact that you watch soccer, but everybody watches soccer in the Netherlands, right? So, now, the original formulations of collaborative filtering focused on modeling the user's item ratings. This is is referred to as rating prediction. And the evaluation of the algorithms originally was also focused on that rating prediction. And this I want to make a big point about. That is quite sad that it happened that way. And actually it happens in any field. So somebody is the first, so the first papers on collaborative filtering are really cool. Right? They do something completely new. It works to a certain degree. They put some data available for others to use and some initial results. Right? Now the problem is that all the people coming after that, they're just gonna reproduce the same experimental setup without thinking too much about it. Which is why now, if you look at the ACM Rexis proceedings, there are still a lot of papers that use exactly the same way of measuring the quality of the results of a collaborative filtering system. Now, why do I go on about it? So, basically you have that item, I don't remember. I forgot if I had the visualization. So, you have this user profile with all the ratings, right? And a lot of the holes, you had to predict the rating, and that is the task. Now, if we have a lot of these predictions on the same items, then we can, of course, try to say, okay, and we have the true data that was held out for the algorithm, then we can compare the predicted rating with the real rating. So I can say, okay, the system predicted 4 stars, but I rated 3 stars. Now, what most of these papers do is they use mean absolute error, so that is just 4 minus 3 in that case is 1. Right? Then I add up all those errors, and the total error after adding up all these differences, that is then should be minimized. Right? Now, what you get, and this is something I have experimental results where I can show that it actually happens. So what you get is that algorithms that improve the number of threes that they have correct, right, get a better score. But maybe they're wrong on the 5s that they get correct. Right? But what are the music items that you want to get back from the recommendation system? They are the 5s. Right? The ratings of the 3s, they're not important. Right? If the system gives it a 3.1 or a 2.9, it's not important. But if you optimize, and especially if you have a large set with 10 million movies and ratings for many, many users, and a standard way of doing a train test split and then cross-validation, and you repeat training the algorithm and predicting the outputs, if what you're measuring then for the optimization criterion is this mean absolute error, well, that's what you ask the system to do. Get as close to all these ratings that are actually insignificant for the user. Right? And I believe that that is also the true explanation why Netflix never used. So there was a Netflix competition. Most of you know about it, I think. You could win $1 million. I thought about participating, and then I saw how many people were trying, and then I gave up before even trying. But some people won this $1 million, actually. So for Netflix as a company, I think it was more a relatively cheap marketing campaign, because so many newspapers started to write about it. They could never have bought that advertisement space for $1 million. But the interesting thing is, and it's actually a nice read, this one. If you use this title in Google, you get it immediately. That the best algorithms out of the competition have never been deployed in practice. And there are two reasons. And one is that they don't really substantially improve the user experience, although they don't write it down so explicitly in public communication. And the other one is that they are big ensembles of many different machine learning techniques grouped together. So we could say they're just overfitting on the competition data. But it's also very expensive to do that. So again, a reminder, if you read this article, you will see only this recency-based recommendations. And maybe that illustrates already, right? So you can make very complicated machine learning-based approaches for recommendation, but it's very hard to really do better than the trivial approaches. All right. So maybe not so strange that in information retrieval we now highlight this point, but the ranking of these recommended items is the essential problem. Because if I want to listen to some music on Spotify, I want the music that fits my taste the best. And those should be the things that are predicted correctly. There is awareness of that in the area. Well, I heard some rumors of people fighting about measures and so on, but a good measure, or at least a usable measure for this type of evaluation would be if we show 5 items, how many would the user actually have liked to listen to? Right? So that's precision at n. And then you know much better approaches already from previous lectures. But this relevance ranking, how am I doing? Oh, perfect. So is the core problem of information retrieval. So organization-wise, so the goal is that I show how the relevance ranking approach from IR also can model these collaborative filtering approaches, so they compare a little bit that they are indeed doing very well. And in the end, I'll even close with work that's not mine, but from Alejandro Belloquin, a postdoc that worked with me, and he has a beautiful IR journal paper that is homework for everybody when you're back in your home university. And then I'll show that you can even use a standard IR system to do all this collaborative filtering stuff very efficiently. And you don't even need to program. But what I wanted to do now is to, before I go into how to apply these relevance models from IR, to briefly summarize the main ideas that underlie this language modeling approach to IR. And I borrow some slides from Victor Lafrenko that we adapted, but they are so beautiful, I thought you should also get it explained this way, right? So this is not my contribution, it's from Victor Lafrenko, really. So life told me on the bus something shocking, and that is that nobody had mentioned the probabilistic ranking principle in the lecture so far. Well, now I've mentioned it. I didn't prepare slides for it, and the bus trip was not long enough. But you do need to read about it. So we first had vector space model, then there were the classic probabilistic models. And the classic probabilistic models are motivated by this probabilistic ranking principle, work by Stephen Robertson. Then there was a whole time there was nothing. Stephen played with the formulas a little bit, and in a paper that he's not too proud of, he invented something called BM25. And then nobody knew how to do better than that anymore, for a long time. Until end 90s, 98, 97 actually, there were 3 places in the world simultaneously where people started to use this type of approaches that I explain now. And I explain this type of approach is that of the probabilistic model, the classic probabilistic model, Because first, this is easier to apply and to relate to all the work going on in machine learning area at the moment. And also because I thought that in the standard lecture you would have had the classic probabilistic model already, so that I would be repeating too many things in my lecture. But so, in the '90s, there was this proposal, and it was actually saying there's all this cool probabilistic modeling stuff from speech recognition and language technologies area, and we can apply that to information retrieval. And now I show some slides that explain how these models are applied to information retrieval. So, the key idea is that you make use of what they call generative models. And what is a generative model? Well, it is a model that generates data in some language. And now I like these slides because it uses a very simple language. It uses a language of colored balls. And that also makes you understand very easily all these all the unigram models that we invented. Because counting balls seems much more natural to do. If your language is colored balls, it makes much more sense that you just count all these events that you observe than if you are talking about something as complex as natural language. Right? So what is the idea of the language modeling approach? Well, that is that you can compute the probability of observing this given a model. And you can do that, well, standard probability is you can just rewrite the left-hand side to the right, to the product of the right-hand side. And then there's the problem that you don't have the numbers for all of those. So now you need to make some assumptions. And the key assumption usually used is that you can just ignore everything that is behind here. So then we can just multiply all these, what we call the unigram models, together to get an estimate for this. So how do you really use these? Well, we don't know the model that we are going to use to predict the relevance. And I now say to predict the relevance, that is the big gap. I'll come back to that. Right? But to compute, so the model here, we can estimate from a sample that is representative of the model. And this is the trick. Now we take the document as we have it. So now the document looks like this. Then we fit the model based on this observation that is this document, and we compute the likelihood of seeing this. And the key idea in the language modeling approach to information retrieval is that what you are going to predict is the words that the user typed as the query. And then the only thing we want to do is find a document that has the highest chance of generating the same thing as what the user typed as the query. And then we assume that that makes that document relevant. Right? Is it my phone? No. So we have the observation for the document, we put it in a model, and then we generate something, and we hope that what we generate is the query, and if the likelihood of that we generate that query is high, then we will say that this is a good answer from an information retrieval system to retrieve that document. Okay. Let me see. So, it is really that simple. Right? The model looks like this. And you just count, okay, for the red one, we have here 4 out of the 9 were red. So we put 4 over 9. And we multiply all these numbers, and that together gives us this estimate of that you would want to retrieve this. We do that for every single document in the collection. And then we pick the one that has the best score. In this case, it would be that one, I think. So now that doesn't work very well. If you have events in the query that were not in the document. Because in this case, the green ball here, green didn't occur in the model, so you get a probability of zero. And well, then you throw away too many of the documents. So we need to do something about that. And the key idea that the way Jurt explained it, Jurt Heemstra, when he developed it, is just we can just average the model from this document with a model from the whole collection. And now you do that for every single document. So for every single document, you have this part that is specific for the document, and this part that is the whole collection. So, and then you say, oh, with a probability of lambda, I will pick a ball from this, and with the remainder probability, I will pick a ball from this. And this model, exactly like this, works extremely well. And it is the basic language modeling approach for query generation. And there's nothing more to it. And the intriguing thing is that this lambda, for the optimum setting, is actually, for most of the collections that we have, is quite low. So a large part of the probability that we use for the ranking comes from this factor that's actually identical for all of the documents that we compute the score for. Very strange. Right? Now there is nice work that explains a little bit more how you can interpret this, and then also relates, if you tweak around with this with the formula, you get like this. Then you can show that this factor plays the same role as in inverse document frequency in the very old models of information retrieval. So now we go back to collaborative filtering. So the question, if we really model the collaborative, the recommendation setup as, okay, find me the 5 songs that I should listen to. Isn't it then exactly the same problem as we study in information retrieval, where we say, okay, give me the 5 documents I should read? And the first work that we managed to apply the relevance models, as I just briefly summarized from Franco and all the language modeling approach for collaborative filtering, is this ECIR paper from 2006. And I'll discuss that in a bit more detail now. So, the idea is really very simple. So if we treat the user profile as the query, and then we do the same type of modeling as we have for if we would have words as a query, then you can also produce a ranking, and hopefully the top items that you will be retrieving for this user profile are then the things that you really want to show to the user. So now in the first part, in the next part of this lecture, I will focus on the approach where we ignore the ratings. So we will look at Spotify case, where you're just listening to music and the thing starts to suggest other music that you might also listen to. This one was what I was looking for. So we have the target items and we have the target user. And what we want is some estimate of the relevance of the target item for this user. Now, if we take the root of what we call item representation, then we will make a model of the user profiles in the of all the user profiles by the items that the target user liked. You can also build a model from what we call user representation. And then you call from the target item the other direction. And both of these approaches you can describe with exactly the same method as this language modeling approach. How do we do that? Well, you have the users, you have the items, and we have the relevance variable. Then what we are going to do is we're going to rank all the items by the Well, this is actually the exact same way as the language modeling papers reuse the classical work from Steve Roberts. So to do the item representation way in a bit more detail. So we have a target user UK and a target item IM. Now, what we will do is we represent the user by the items. And we use the items that I like to represent that user. Right? Now we assume that all the item ratings, well, they are not ratings, they are just the fact that the user listened to the item, that they are independent from each other. Then you can follow the same derivations as our presented for if you would have words and documents. What did I want to highlight? If you do that, you end up with a probabilistic justification of the item-based collaborative filtering model that was around for much longer. What's interesting is that the value that you end up computing is based on two factors. Here you have the popularity of the item, which is basically just how often people listen to the song. Right? And we have the co-occurrence that this item occurs in a user's profile. And what happens is that this item co-occurrence is emphasized if more users express interest in both the target and the query item. And that is why it ends up at the top of the bar. Or it's the other way around. We first derive the model and now we interpret it. Right? At the bottom, you see the popularity of the query item. And what that actually says is that okay, that somebody else listened to this Beatles song is interesting, right? That you listen to it as well, but it is listened to so often that it doesn't carry much information. Right? And that's why it goes in the denominator. So you can walk through the same approach by using the user representation case. Now you represent the items by the users that liked it, instead of representing the users by the items that they liked. I have later on, by the way, some visualizations that are actually more clear, I think. But sorry about that. I realize it's a bit complicated now. So, if we represent the target items by the users who like it, and we assume all the user profiles are independent, then we can again follow the standard derivations of the language modeling approach for information retrieval. And what we end up with is a very similar case, where you can see that the co-occurrence of the target user and other users is being rewarded. And then it is normalized by the popularity of the other user. So, which means is that a user likes every movie that there is, then it doesn't help a lot to look at that the items that those users like, because they it doesn't carry information, right? They have all the time of the world, they watch all the movies. Okay. Now, and then we are in information retrieval, so we're always measuring how well it works. Here you see two things that you also see with most of the text retrieval variants. Basically that the choice of lambda doesn't matter a lot for a large range, so it's fairly stable. But you do get better retrieval, and actually here the lambda should be quite high for the better retrieval case. Well, this is what did I want to highlight there? Let me go. Sorry about that. So what I hope I managed to show is that you have these user item relevance models. They are based on the IR models that we have developed for text, and they actually help us understand why the collaborative filtering methods work. But they also, through the smoothing approach, they give a good way of handling the problem of sparsity. We can also show that they work as well as or better than competing approaches that are derived from just some matrix computation framework. Now at the moment we did a case where we ignored the ratings and we turned it just into this was seen or listened to. And now we want to bring in the ratings, and then we get to a situation slightly different. So these are the visualizations that I promised that are a bit easier to understand. Another way of looking at the same approach of collaborative filtering. The question is, can we predict this value? Now, what we've seen so far is that we can represent. What we can try to do is order all the other item profiles here by similarity to the item profile that contains the rating that we try to predict. Right? So I've turned this one into this one based on the similarity between these columns in the matrix. Right? And now what happens when we do rating prediction in all of the approaches is that we start to aggregate the scores that we know from the ratings into a new rating. Right? But what I also want to highlight is that in these very similar profiles, that is called the neighborhood, right? So the neighborhood that provides the basis for the recommendation prediction, there are a lot of cases where you have unknown ratings. Right? Because this profile can be very similar, but may not have a rating for the object that we want to find a rating for. You can do the same in that matrix by ordering the rows on similarity. Right? So this is then the we order on user similarity, so we have here all the ratings from one user. So here all the items are represented by all their users. So this is the user-based collaborative filtering. Right? And now again, what you see is that, okay, some of the ratings we have, but some are missing. Right? And whether you have cast the problem as the nice probabilistic way based on language modeling in IR, or you had just the original, let's do the similarity between these rows and we do the average of those ratings, it doesn't really matter. In both cases, you're also you need to do something with these missing values. Right? And there's nobody telling you really what to do with the missing values. So usually they are just filled with the average. With the average rate. Now, so it doesn't matter if you do item-based or user-based collaborative filtering, right? You include these not so similar users. Now, when we thought about it, so we first had the normal collaborative filtering approaches, then we were playing with, okay, can we cast this as language modeling approach, just like we do in IR? And then we were thinking again more like, okay, what is happening actually? And then we had a simple idea, well, why not combine user and item-based? So especially after I showed it to you like this, with this one and this one, it looks like a trivial idea, right? Now, I wrote many papers that are very complicated, but the paper about this very trivial idea, that is the one that gets cited a lot. So I don't know, part of the summer school is, of course, to give advice. If you can find something trivial that has not been done, you get rewarded much more in academia for that, yeah, than if you find something very complicated that a lot of people thought about and they couldn't work out, but there are all the intermediate steps already, and then you finally have the breakthrough. Okay, you get some credits for that, but that is usually not what makes you very respected. So this sick IR paper has more than 500 citations. And the only thing we do there is this. We basically say, well, we could sort the neighborhood both on item similarity and user similarity and take scores from this square basically and combine all these numbers that we have ratings for into the prediction. Okay, how do we do that? Well, we just extend the model with something that we called indicator variables. And the indicator variables, they just say that we will take a rating from either the item-based or from the user-based or from the mixed area. Now, I'll do a sketch of the, you can look at the paper, then you get a real derivation. But I'll show you a little bit like how easy it is to do that. Because basically, okay, we try to predict that rating from all these different ratings that we have. Right? We have the, oh yeah, why is it called SUR? Similar user rating. Similar item rating, and this is similar user item rating. And those are the ones, these are the ones on the column and on the row, and these are the ones in that square area. Right? Now, you can put these indicator variables in, and then you marginalize over those values, right? And then it goes into the formulation where these pi2 is 1 and the 1 minus pi2 is 1 are just briefly abbreviated with a delta. And then we can do the same thing again for the middle part. And what we get is a formulation that takes a certain weighted form of the ratings here, the ratings there, and the ratings in this neighborhood. So, let's reflect a little bit. So, we've talked about information retrieval area, that we had these relevance models, and that we then use item representation, user representation. That was all cast nicely as probabilistic models. Now, we propose this similarity fusion, where you mix these representations. They're a bit more closer in this machine learning area, in a way. And that is why the paper gets cited a lot. People in machine learning thought like, oh, actually, nice all those language models from information retrieval people. We have much better ways of combining these different sources. And that generates these 500 other papers that refer to it, because they just have better ways to learn those weights. Now, in the SICKIR paper, which did get accepted for SICKIR, we do something ugly, because we say that these probabilities of that that the user rating, the probabilities for the user ratings and for the item ratings, we take them immediately by the similarity distances in the matrix. So if we have the two columns, we compute the distance between the two columns. And then what we do, that distance, we say that is like the probability. Which is not a very elegant approach. It is followed a lot in information retrieval, actually. The there are many papers where you look at pseudo-relevance feedback approaches. And then when the pseudo-relevance feedback comes in, they want to do something with clustering. Then even though everything is nicely presented as probabilistic models, then often the clustering suddenly is quasi-similarity based. And then the quasi-similarities are transferred into probabilities again, and then we continue. And at the end we say, oh, we have very beautiful probabilistic model. Now, I was bothered by that, more than Jun actually. I think Jun was just very happy with the citations. but we did a much nicer version. But I will not go over it now. It is a very complicated paper, has many pages, has proofs with EM algorithms derived and everything. So if you're interested in that stuff, it's better to read the paper. But what we do there is we, and if you're interested in reading the paper, what I say now, listen very carefully because it will help a lot. There are two uses of the word kernel in the paper. There is a classic approach that if you have point observations and you want to turn that into a distribution, then one thing you can do is you can put a little distribution around every point, like a Gaussian distribution, for example, and then add up all those little Gaussians together. And then you get a huge mixture of Gaussians. In fact, it is a mixture of Gaussians, right? And the nice thing what you get then is that it is smooth. And you have a value for every point. So if we would do it on the, there's no whiteboard, right? So if you would have just a one-dimensional value, then you get a line, and every point in the line you get a little Gaussian around it, and because you add up all these Gaussians, then suddenly you have everywhere some probability mass. So you get a nice density out of it. And that is from signal processing, and the technique is called Parchin window kernel density estimation. And the kernel there refers to the little distribution that you put around every point. There's in machine learning, when they ended up with the support vector machines, they use something else that is called the kernel trick. What do you do with the kernel trick? Well, you map the distribution that you have into some on a limited number of data into some infinite space. And then very smart mathematicians have shown that if you have dot products in the original space, they can be mapped on the infinite space. But in the infinite space, you can construct it in such a way that you get nice properties, so that you can learn a function that linearly separates the positive and the negative examples, and then you can map it back to your space. And that's what a support vector machine does. That, and the key mechanism there is the kernel trick. But that is then a different kernel than the kernel in kernel density estimation. And a nice thing of this paper is, okay, to get rid of that similarity distance and do everything probabilistically, is that we use both the kernel trick and kernel density estimation. But that makes the paper really hard to explain, because the word kernel gets a bit overloaded. All right. So you can do everything that is in the SICKIR paper nicely in a truly probabilistic approach. And then we were very happy that we did that. But actually the model that you then end up with is not so easy to use and to adapt for different cases. So I'm not sure if I would stand for that it is a better approach. So and why I'm discussing this? Well, we get back to that later on, when I'm even gonna talk about the vector space model again. Oh horror. So another side note. In information retrieval, we have a lot of work on relevance feedback. Now that we cast collaborative filtering with all these information retrieval approaches, we can also carry over other ideas from IR, and they turn out to work. So this is a fairly recent paper from the same group with Alejandro Beloquin and Pablo Castells. They produce a lot, by the way. In that paper, they show that if you apply the idea of pseudo-relevance feedback from information retrieval to this setup with collaborative filtering, then you get very good results. And if the results are really correct, then there is no better model at the moment. It's my impression. So, back to my real story. So we are wondering, is collaborative filtering and information retrieval then not really the same? Right, from different perspectives. So there are a lot of hints that you can do very good recommendation approaches by reusing things that we learned in information retrieval through the years. So now we take one step further, and this is the journal paper by Alejandro that I mentioned. In this case, we go as far. We use the full machinery of IR with inverted files and retrieval systems, and we build a recommendation system without adapting the technology. And then we will see that we get big advantages from modeling collaborative filtering as information retrieval. So you've seen this, right, earlier in the presentations. Now the question is, can we just replace the inputs to the IR system to make it a recommendation system? Now, we talked about this formula before. Remember, this was either the row-wise or the column-wise that you compute these similarities between the whole rows or the whole columns, and then you average the ratings that you see into a predicted rating. Now, this is another paper I want you all to know. So if you go back to retrieval models, right, there are so many papers written about retrieval models, it's very hard to know where to start and which ones do you need to read in detail. But take this one as a starting point. It is very useful to read. What Don Metzler and Hugo Zaragoza together observed is basically that all the models that we have been proposing, or virtually all of the models, they boil down to just a sum of products between the query term weight and the document term weight. And you can cast all of these models just as variants of these products. So in the simplest TF idea, in the simplest TF model or the TF IDF model, you have different instantiations of what you put in these weights, right? But in the end, how you compute the relevant status value is always just the sum of these products of these weights. And now, what Alex noticed is that you can do the same for collaborative filtering. It's somewhat obvious, maybe after all the previous setup. And basically, it boils down to that you have in the document side and the query side, you use either a normalization of these weights or not. What do I mean? You do the normalization either with L1 norm or L2 norm. So if you then use the term frequency formulation with L1 normalization, then and you fill that in the formula here for the average of these weights, then what you see is that it is equivalent to item-based collaborative filtering. And now comes the interesting bit. So this is the performance of the instantiation of the recommendation system using the different weighting formulas that we have developed in IR in the past. And here you see the effectiveness of the resulting system. So what we see here basically is the TFL1SO1, which is the classic rating-based collaborative filtering, is at the complete bottom of this line. And here you see basically different ways to instantiate these two components that are motivated from previous models developed in all this information retrieval literature. Like here you have BM25 where you use L1 weighting for both the query and the document. And then you get a much better, in this case, NDCG of, and this was on movie lens. So you get a much better NDCG of the top movies that are recommended to the user. And the best model somehow turns out to be a TF-based model for collaborative filtering in movie lens. Well. So, how do we actually do that? So, the tricky thing to come by, you may have been wondering that, and then you think like, oh, Arjen is rambling all the time, he'll stop talking at some point, and then I go home safely. But I'll say a little bit more about it. So, why is it difficult to do recommendation with the IR approach? Well, we don't really have the common thing between the users and the items. And remember in the beginning I had that graph where we had here the item and here the user, and there was this arrow in between, right? And we had to go via either the users or the items to make that bridge. That is because we don't have the common access that we have for document retrieval. We have the words. And when I type my query, I have the words to write my query in. So the solution is that you have to project the users and the items in a common space. And then you can realize that actually what we've been talking about so far is just two extreme settings. What we do is we project the users into a space with a dimensionality of the number of items, or the other way around. We project the items in the space with the dimensionality of the users. Yeah, and that is the item or the user representation. And then we compute the distances in that space. That's when we compare the rows in the columns in the matrix. Yeah, we have represented everything as user ratings, but that's just one of these extreme cases. You could use other projections, right? Let me go about it for a little while. So, if we, no, this is not what I wanted to show. So, what is, what I wanted to come back to is that the only thing that so you can use much more linear algebra than we have been doing so far. That's the bottom line. So we can project the users and items in any shared space. The only thing that we would like to have it is that they that that space is what they call orthonormal. Well, this you might remember from your first class calculus when you studied computer science or mathematics. Right? For me, that's longer ago, so I'm struggling a little bit in explaining it very clearly. So you can construct a space, and this is the space of the all the users and the items. You can compute the covariance matrix of that space, of the data that you have constructed, and then you can show that that covariance matrix is positive semi-definite. And then there is a theorem from linear algebra that says that there will exist an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. Well, what does that really mean? It basically means that there are many more cases than the two extremes that would also work. Right? So you can map the rating information that we have into different spaces that are constructed from the items and the user dimensions. And if you do that, and you do that nicely, then you can derive in the end, you can compute the dot product of the user vector mapped in that space and the item vector mapped in that space. And then what you end up with is actually the same formulation that you see for all the IR models in the Metzler and Zaragoza paper. So with a bit of arithmetic starting from the user item matrix, we can show that the task of collaborative filtering, of recommendation, gets the same form as the IR models that we have developed over the time. So it's just another way to arrive at the same result. And this way, okay, I think I didn't explain it so well. I need to work on that, especially now that I need to teach this more often to bachelor students rather than master students. What I want to highlight is that if you go back to linear algebra, then you can actually arrive at the same results again. Right? So now we've seen some very ad hoc approach with the we take the, some similarity between these user or item profiles, and then we average the result with some sort of smart weighting, and then we predict the ratings. Right? So that was the initial case of a bit ad hoc collaborative filtering approaches. And that was first shown by Patty Maas. Then we can also approach it with a very probabilistic modeling motivated way, using the same analogies from language modeling for information retrieval, and we can arrive at models. We have less choices about what do we do with the missing values. They come nicely through the process of smoothing that we developed before for information retrieval. And we get better results. That was also nice. Right? And now we do even a further step back. We go back to this just vector spaces. And we represent our information as vectors in these high-dimensional spaces. And in the end, the similarities, they become dot products. And actually, the big question that I want to work towards is what should we prefer as an approach? Right. So I'll first finish this bit where I show how to now use the standard IR machinery. But keep that in mind. I'll come back to that in the wrap up. So So in collaborative filtering literature, you will see that people use the approach that I've been discussing most, the rating item rating based approach. We average these distances to predict the rate, missing ratings. That's done in the original space, and that is known as the memory-based approaches to collaborative filtering. Now, people very early on already said, like, you can use a lower dimensional space, because this original high-dimensional space of all the items, all the users, is far too sparse to be useful. And then you can use techniques like singular value decomposition, and which is generally as a group referred to as matrix vectorization. You can apply those methods to shrink the user item matrix. So you get a much lower dimensional problem. That follows more from this algebraic formulation of the problem. But in our domain, we have been trying that as well, and then it's referred to as latent semantic indexing, which is the case from Sudume in the original vector space formulation, or all the variants that are known as probabilistic, LSA, and all its variants. Where the same idea is applied to the probabilistic models. Now, the question still remains, okay, with this smart mappings, right, we can transfer the original user item based approach into something that we could execute on an IR system. Now, how do we go about that? So we have the original user item matrix, and we turn it into the similarity matrix between all the items by using the dot product. Now, we can store the similarities here into the standard inverted file index. There is a problem in the sense that when we developed inverted file retrieval systems for IR, and I know that you had a 2-hour lecture about all the tricks of the trade to make it fast, right? Then we know that the word occurrences are Zipfian distributed. That is not the case for the ratings in the problem of collaborative filtering. So doing this approach of app using a retrieval system implementation for building a recommender system may not reach the best efficiency, because actually the posting lists can get quite long for many more users or items than in the case that we use it for text retrieval. Now, the weighting schemes that we can I take a short break, sorry. Yeah. So remember that formulation of the the collaborative filtering approach as a product of these different weightings. Right? Then here you have the different settings for the values in the rating matrix that correspond to the different models. And if you plug in these formulations for the different weights, then you get these corresponding models. Now these rates are the ones that you're gonna store in the inverted file system for the collaborative filtering case. Now, this is not so interesting. It just shows that the different models have a different performance, but what is interesting is this one. So here we have the matrix vectorization approach. What we see is that on the ranking task, so to produce the 30 best movies to watch or the 5 best songs to listen to, the matrix vectorization is slightly better than, is way better than the user-based collaborative filtering approach, but it is much worse than the more advanced IR models that we developed. Right? And you see that also for the larger data set with 10 million users. Again, the matrix vectorization line here is better than the simplest approaches, but is much worse than the recommendation algorithm that you get if you use state-of-the-art information retrieval models as a motivation. That is not what is known so well in the literature. Here is if you look at the evaluation results where your task is rating prediction. If you look here, then there is one method that stands out. Remember that for this mean absolute error, what you measure is the deviation from the ratings that you have in your ground truth and the ratings that were predicted. Just by subtracting the predicted rating and the known rating and taking the absolute value and summing that up. So for this mean absolute error, you see that matrix vectorization is much better, right? And this is, I think, so this comes back to this problem, and it is the case for both of the approaches, whether you do item-based or user-based modeling. Here you see what happens if you change the way you evaluate. So for the Netflix competition that I mentioned before, the criterion what was optimized was this mean absolute error on the ratings of the movies. So techniques like matrix vectorization worked really well. If you think about using Netflix, you have watched a movie and you want to know what should I watch next, if I still don't want to go to sleep yet, then I'm interested in these numbers. And here, actually, matrix vectorization is not good at all. Right? So, I generally like the probabilistic approaches to both retrieval and recommendation. But I do want to make some side remarks. So these models are elegant, right? But if you really think about what we learned from applying it to the problem of recommendation, it is not so clear how much better it is and how much better we understand the problem than we already understood it when we just had the vector space model. But if you would write a paper, and this is a lesson that I'm not sure that I want to endorse, but it is one that is true. Yeah. If you write a paper where you say we take the vector space model, we use LNU, LTC, and then you study some interesting aspect of retrieval, then you always get reviews back, reject, you use some ad hoc methods, right? And it is not elegant. If you take a nice probabilistic modeling approach with a lot of formulas and you present exactly the same idea with all those nice probabilistic formulas, then people, you can have two reactions. One could be, why did you not use this much more advanced probabilistic model that you could also have used? Right? That is if you are a bit unlucky and you get a machine learning researcher as your reviewer. Or you get your paper accepted because it is generally, it was a good idea. Let's assume we have something about a good idea, right? Now, I think it's not fair, right? I don't think the idea changed by changing the formulas if in the end the way the problem is tackled is the same. So I'm still not recommending you to try then, Arjen said it should be okay. Let's just do some dot product in some space and I do my work with that approach. Right? One aspect of all this work on the casting the approaches probabilistically that is very attractive is that you use a language that that other researchers in neighboring fields are very used to. Right? So if you use a generative model, then many more, both in natural language processing and in machine learning, people can understand what you try to describe. If you go back to all sort of nice approaches with based on just a vector space and then we do some weighting here and look, we have really cool results, then it is harder for others to get to what you were exactly doing. The downside is, I think, and this we as a field should be thinking about, to cast everything correctly as in probabilistic models, well, first of all, we don't always do it. We write a lot of formulas, but if you really start to look at it as a mathematician, then there are a lot of corners cut. Like the example that I mentioned explicitly is that we take a distance in some high-dimensional space, and then from now on we call it a probability. Yeah? Or we say we compute the probability of relevance. Well, in the language modeling approach, we don't compute the probability of relevance. And still everybody writes, or not everybody, but most of the papers that come out will say, we will compute the probability of relevance. Well, you compute the probability that you generate, in my case it was the user profile or the item profile, or the probability that you generate the query, right? And then we make an equation where we say that this similarity that we compute probabilistically is the same as the probability of relevance. And then people even write that therefore they can use the probability ranking principle as a justification for why this model is so good. So I don't have really good recommendations. That was the topic of the talk. To how to continue from there. So I think it is fair that we use these probabilistic approaches. You can be very pedantic about what you write, that you don't write probability of relevance, but then you get a lot of text to describe what you actually are doing that consumes space in your paper from what you should have been explaining what was new. So I think it's going to be very hard for us to get rid of this somewhat incorrect use of writing about generative models, language models, in relation to the classic retrieval model. And if you're interested in this type of really fundamental approaches, then you should read yet another paper, more homework. I should have put it here, but And that is by Stephen Robertson, a paper on event spaces for probabilistic models in information retrieval. So if you, a lot of people say that the classic probabilistic model and the language modeling approach are just different views of the same problem. But Stephen Robertson will be very insulted if you say that. I understand what he means, so sometimes in my reviewing I use that as a complaint, but it's also not fair to reject papers that are just repeating what has already been accepted so many times. So yeah, I think I should stop with this reflection now. It will get confusing. But it's a complicated problem. And it's just a different instantiation of exact same problem that the recommendation systems people have. How do you get rid of mean mean absolute error as an evaluation metric on the rating predictions? How do you get rid of that? Because we know it's not very good. It doesn't represent what the recommendation system should be doing. But people keep using it, and then the approach is in. Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, okay.
I just wanted to say on that point that the probabilistic models, right, do add some extra value because, you know, having a probability means that you can work out the log odds, which gives you an area that you can interpret that. You can know that this is three times more likely to be relevant than something else, right? So it's a much more interpretable value than the value in the vector space.
That would be true if we would be able to compute the probability of relevance, but we can't. So we have all these steps where we say we compute something that has the same order as the probability of relevance. But then your example of that is three times as good, that's not valid anymore. Because we have transferred the original ranking of these probabilities of relevance that we would like to compute. We can't compute them, so we make some assumptions. We compute something that has the same order.
Yeah,
but then you cannot compare these absolute numbers anymore.
In theory, it's nicer, but
yeah, exactly. Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. So it's true. In theory, it would be very nice. But maybe we cannot have the theory operationalized in such a way that it's still better. Yeah. It's just a remark. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
The starting point is, I agree that the starting point is your probabilities, but as soon as you start to make the assumptions, you do exactly what you said. You change the scales, as I pointed out in my lecture, and you are losing the notion of ratios and intervals and so on.
So I'm not completely decided that I would say don't do probabilistic approaches anymore. Right? Actually, I do them all the time in my work. Because I also know how to write about it. But I don't think we always, first, we don't always use it correctly, and we don't spend enough time on trying to use it correctly, because we also need the graphs that show that our approach is so much better in mean average precision than the other approach. Right? So in the way we work as a field, you don't always have time to the opportunity to make it really work.
But I think if you're doing a PhD now, like you're developing your PhD, if you come from a more theoretical basis and say, this is the formal model I propose, if I'm doing here, I've tried to implement it as best I can, but it's failed, you're going to be in a better position to argue your case than if you take an ad hoc approach and say, oh, here's my ad hoc approach, and it's failed. Well, then you go, well, what are you saying? You're on very shaky ground.
So I think my point is that using a vector modeling approach and distances in high dimensionality and then reasoning about those distances and deriving properties of those distances is not an ad hoc approach. Right? So yes, if you would be able to derive in your PhD work the real way of computing or estimating or predicting very closely the probability of relevance, and it's due to your contribution that you now really compute the probability of relevance, that would be amazing, right? Much better than all the other ways of doing it. Because they are also closer to this probabilistic ranking principle and its variants that we are proposing now, like the interactive probability of ranking principle. But if you cannot do that, and you're just transforming some numbers and approximations, then I don't think it is better to cast it as a very nice way with probabilistic formulas than if you would cast it in a very nice linear algebra model. Right? And that's the. So I think we are very critical, and as soon as we see something that is okay, we have a distance in this high dimensional space, and now we study these properties, then we're gonna say, this is ad hoc, I don't like it, we reject it. Right? And so another concluding remark is, but that is also not so interesting for all the students maybe, because you're here at SR, so you want to go to SICIR, right? But there, at the meta level, it is interesting that that we have come about to have two different communities that study more or less the same problem, which is, what is the relevant information to give to users in response to their needs? But if we use mean absolute error and a lot of difficult machine learning methods, then we call it recommendation systems, and we go to ACM-REXIS. And there are not a lot of people that go to ACM-REXIS and SICIR. And that's a pity. What? And I think if you remember that I had in the middle, I had this framework where you had on the left-hand side, yeah, the IR, and on the right-hand side, the machine learning. And I think it exactly has to do with that. So if people come from machine learning and are motivated by AI-like questions, and then they are intrigued by the web and modern information systems, and they like applications, the same ones that we like, then they end up at ACM-REXIS. And if you start from the user who is looking for information, and you're interested in that, and you want to model that, then you end up at the Information Retrieval Conference. So we see that there are cross correlations, right? We can do collaborative filtering with IR models. We can probably do IR with the models from the early collaborative systems, recommendation systems approaches. We would call them then ad hoc and rejected, right? But yeah, it's a pity in a way that this is going in parallel and there is not a lot of crossover. So we've tried a little bit of crossover, but I think at the moment the REXIS community is growing and we are not growing. So I hope we can stay, we can survive, and we can say that IR is not applied machine learning. Now, if you got interested in these models or in the general problem of recommendation, and you don't want to necessarily go to REXIS, because SICIR and PISA, that will be amazing. So then I want to, as a end of my lecture, I want to advertise a little bit a recent track at track that studies basically recommendation. So it's called the contextual suggestion track. So the task here is that you will get a user profile and the context. And the what you need to do is make suggestions for that user in its context. Here we have again, in REXIS, people refer to this as context-aware recommendation. If you read the report from the strategic retreat in Lorne, then we will refer to it as zero query information retrieval. Right? So there was a series of workshops started by Jaap Kamps and Charlie Clark, and it was called Entertain Me. And they were workshops at SICIR. If there is one, again, Or if there is a workshop organized by Jaap, that is sort of a proxy of that. And you don't know what workshop to go to, then I recommend to go to that one, because they always have a fun evening program. So in the entertainment workshop, what they did was they talked about different ways of how to recommend things to do in the evening. And then they actually went to that in the evening. Although I'm not sure if it was system-generated recommendations. But so what they started to do, inspired by the experience of these workshops, is that they wanted a test collection-based approach, a track for IR researchers that models a recommendation problem that includes context. And I think they did a reasonable job of that. So I'm advertising it here, because then maybe they get more participants. It's not that they have no participants, but it could be better. So the idea is you want to recommend to a user things to do. And the user profile has opinions about attractions. Attractions are like restaurants, or events, theme parks, zoos. The context is very limited. The context is just a geolocation. So the query is the geolocation, right? And the result list should be a list of attractions for that user on that location. Now, how do they set it up? So they collected information about point of interest in a specific two specific cities. That's actually where they have the people who will make relevance assessments in the end as well, who will evaluate the recommendations that they receive. And they constructed a user profile out of that. And all of these points of interest, so here you see one, this 120 point of interest number 125, right, is the Adler Planetarium and Astronomy Museum. Okay, and it has a bit of text and a URL. You're allowed to use all of that in your system if you see a way to do it. The user here has liked that point of interest, and they didn't like the Lincoln Park Zoo. So you get user profiles like this, and you get the context, and in this case we know that the context is metropolitan areas in the US. That is due to the way they need to evaluate things, so they are all in the US. And now the task is, okay, you need to suggest web pages and snippets. But don't worry, most of the people that participate don't have very good approaches to producing the snippets that you show. It's pretty ad hoc, very different than the ad hoc we talked about before. But so the task for your system is to, you have received the location and the user, and you know the user profile. What attractions in that new location would you want to direct the user to? And then there are two modes of operations. One is from the open web and one is from CluWeb. And so what most of the participants do is they use open web search engines like Google or Microsoft, Bing. Almost forgot to mention it. Or Yahoo search, to produce a ranking, and then they build a recommendation system on top of the top N results from that open web system. And you're allowed to do that in this track. I think it is terrible that we're allowed to do that, because we don't know how that ranking, which is the main input for the results, is actually produced, right? Because it's done by some magical billion-dollar company for us, but they don't tell us how it is produced. And there's actually a lot of handwork in it and so on. So the other mode is much more interesting. what you do there is you get CLUWeb and you take the web pages from CLUWeb and you recommend the web pages from CLUWeb that are best for that location. Right? Now, you would think that that is what IR researchers would want to do, because then it's reproducible and you can understand what happens. But there are only two or three teams that do this mode of operation. One of the teams is us, that's why I'm advertising it now. We need more participation of people who want to actually do the task for real. Otherwise it will disappear again. And I think this is a very nice challenging problem. Yeah, it is a problem of recommendation, but the retrieval part is also important. And what we've been finding so far is that it's actually really, really hard if you use standard information retrieval approaches on CLUWeb to find good attractions. And you will probably need to do something about integrating other sources of information from, for example, Foursquare. So there, what happens? We need the user judgments that are then, in this case, stored on Foursquare, for example, on those attractions. We need more information from users on the attractions. The content about the attractions is not good enough to make good suggestions. That's what we learned so far. So I hope that some of you think, go home and, or at least tell your lab mate that is just starting out the PhD, I know a good topic. I wish I knew that 2 years ago. But you can do it. Yeah. And that is the problem of contextual suggestion. Come to track, participate, and apply this mix of recommendation and search, and try to help us cast it as a reproducible problem. Yeah. Oh yeah, and this is just, if you go through all the papers of participants, whether they use Open Web or CLUWeb, they will do this. Usually this candidate selection prior is usually Boolean. It is, did the search engine Bing retrieve the document in the top 10 or not, right? And then they do a mixture of similarities of the positive things in the user profile with the thing, with the attraction that we are considering. And we subtract another, a weighted version of the negative user profile. And what people have shown so far, and especially in the open web setting, the results are, they look like they can produce lists of recommendations that users would like in practice, or there's enough information there. But what is interesting is that all these approaches, they all look like this, and they all have a lambda that's non-zero. Whereas in most of the information retrieval papers and works that I know of, there is no role for negative feedback. Right? There are only very few exceptions where negative feedback is turned into something useful. So if we don't do the traditional search application, but we move to something like, okay, let's see what we do tonight. Can the system help me? Then suddenly other aspects in the whole setup start to play a big role. Now, and now I will really stop talking. Oh yeah, if you couldn't follow what I was saying, and I realized that there was a moment in my lecture that this might have happened, then this is the set of papers that is the primary reading list. But you can also send me email and I will try to give a more coherent answer. And I want to thank the people that did the most for this. So Alejandro and Jun, with them I really worked on recommendation and trying to see how we can mix it with ideas from information retrieval. And Thijs and Victor just were the ones making the beautiful slides for the language modeling explanation with the colored balls. Okay.
So any questions?
Yeah.
I didn't quite get the way you create this assessments in this last task.
Ah, yeah, that is interesting. Well, actually, so I'm just advertising Charlie and Jaap's task, right? But so they have, they somehow arrange that the people who make the profiles are also the people making the assessments. And what they get is they get a web page with the top 10 or something results from one of the recommendation systems, or maybe it's pooled, I don't remember. But they get a list with these snippets, and then they can link on to the underlying page, and they collect relevance assessments both on the snippet level and on the page level. But what I think is interesting is that it is really not just a held out data exercise, like with the using movie lens or something, but it's really the people who made a user profile in city Chicago are also evaluating the recommendations for the city that they probably live or at least know well enough, that they get recommendations for from the systems. So there are real people looking at the results that know that they would actually consider that restaurant and they would never go to that club because it's only 80s disco.
So there is, the user profiles are made up.
I think they also come from the users.
I was wondering about the effect of popularities. If you're going to a new place, there is a balance between your particular
so they,
and
yeah,
things
yeah.
that you should go there because everyone goes, so
yeah.
They
I don't know if they really analyze that. So one trick is that they choose the locations for which you have to make recommendations that they're not the biggest places in the US. So they use the profile from Chicago, but then ask you to recommend it for, well, here it was Kalamazoo. I don't even know where that is, other than that it must be in Michigan. And that was for that reason, because if you would ask for recommendations for Paris, then you would get the Eiffel Tower and the Louvre, and then it would be, that would not be a good representation. So their workaround is to ask for less known places, and then they hope that that effect is less significant. But yeah, there will be this popularity effect. Yeah.
No. Nope. I mean, it is very easy to recommend a Tour Eiffel or a very well-known movie and so on. It is more difficult to recommend something which is not so popular. And, but this is not measured in the evaluation metrics, right?
No. No, I don't think so. And I also, yeah, so what they do have is measures that try to encourage diversity. But and then that's sometimes genre related or something. But I still think it's not.
I've been discussing with Alejandro.
Huh?
I mean, that would be interesting to do.
Yeah. You would. So it will be tricky to formulate it in such a way that actually it does model something real.
It's tricky because, I mean, you want to reward system that provide you peculiar suggestions,
yeah.
But you want to penalize systems that do not give you the common ones,
the easy ones.
So it's quite tricky.
Yeah. And if you have not seen a particular popular movie, that doesn't mean that you don't want to see it because it was popular. Yeah.
Also the problem of trivially obvious suggestions. So we're working with restaurant recommendation at the moment.
Mm.
And there are a couple of restaurants that everyone already knows. If you live in the city, you know, there's no way you haven't heard about the most expensive or the most popular restaurant. But if you give that as a recommendation, it doesn't add anything to the experience of the user. You know, you show that and they never come back to your system because they already know everything. The only way so far we found one is to actually
Yeah, now we had the same problem with this. I didn't discuss it, but with Maarten Clemens, we worked on also recommending places to visit. based on geotags in Flickr images. And there you had that exact problem. So we used Paris, and then we do find, yeah, okay, everybody makes a photo of the Eiffel Tower when they go there, right? Even Ricardo last week says he don't like selfies, but he couldn't resist this one. So, but you don't need to recommend to go to the Eiffel Tower. So one way we worked around this was to try to see if what is the difference that your system adds in the order in which you might actually reach some locations that you have been. So did they actually move up? And then, okay, the Eiffel Tower is on top, and it is also on top with your approach. But maybe it was much lower, some other Père Lachaise was very low originally, but because your information was added to the system, it knows that Père Lachaise should go much higher up. And then we were only reporting how much higher up the good things went. But that is a very engineering workaround, and it's not really telling you if the user first would like it, and second, if they go low enough in the list to actually reach Père Lachaise. And if you just look at P at 5 or P at 10, then we had the problem that it is only these popular things that come in. And if you don't give the popular things, then it's so much harder that you will be beaten by the simple system. So that problem, I think you all mentioned the same problem. I don't know of a proper workaround other than do it with real users. I think you also had the question. Yeah.
It's a little bit like the negative part. You mentioned that the personalization, where you take into account that, you know, something that you don't like, you want to penalize them. But it's usually that something that I like, maybe something I don't like so much, my friends might like, so I say, okay, we still go, right? So it's a different scenario.
Yeah. So I like music a lot, but the music that I like is not always enjoyed by my family. So the best music for me, I cannot play unless I use headphones. It's a similar setting. So I like that that as a context, but did you have a specific question about that? Or more just to remark that, yeah, okay.
Yeah, I went back to popularity, the meaning of the lecture was this example about user recommendation.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm not gaining any actual knowledge. And maybe I was reading about the crisis in the immigration in Europe, and then there are just the popular news on the right hand of the web page, and then not knowing and not adding any new knowledge about the first topic. No?
So yes,
how can we devise some tasks?
So I knew about, I had those concerns myself, right? But before we participated in the challenge. But participating in the challenge made it just more obvious that it is a problem. So I agree with you. Although, so if you run the newspaper, you do want the recommendations there that people are gonna follow up. Right? So modeling the click, so modeling performance by click-through rate is not a bad idea. Mm-hmm. But I was very disappointed in the way it works out then in practice, and also in that the simplest algorithm of most recent popular is doing so well that it's very hard to beat it. To come back to your real the fundamental notion in your question, I think there are two aspects. So one is we might want to make systems that help people behave better. But that is a bit paternalistic view in a way. Because if you're just reading the news, maybe you're happy to read something else than that you can talk about at the coffee machine later,
yeah,
or that your friends talk about, right? So that's also important. And maybe you don't need to know everything about the financial crisis in X or the immigration problem. On the other hand, if you want to know about the immigration model, there's not problems. There is not really a good way to tell a current news outlet that that is what you really want to know more about. So I don't know how to solve that, but I think it would be interesting if we can express our intents better to the websites that we're using. So if I can say like, okay, I don't want to be entertained now, or I don't want the daily update now. I want to learn about why is there this problem with house prices in the Netherlands. It suddenly became relevant for me again. And yeah, it will also be tricky to find out how you get the users, the people who go to the site, to actually be able to realize that, oh, now today I'm not reading the news, I wanted to know more about the topic, so I need to click that button there or something. Mm-hmm. So this is a big challenge. Katja is trying to intervene a few times already. Well, the latter thing is true. You don't have a lot of information from a specific user because it is just what you get from the Plista platform. Yeah, you can track it. You can track it over time, and you get a little bit of information of what they guess about the location. And I think they were planning to put also in features like the income or guest income. Yeah, so and at the moment you can't really do that as a participant, other than look at the scrambled IP address. So there is a thing that is related to the cookies, and that allows you to trace users over time, but it's of course far from perfect, and the Plista platform is probably not as good in it as the people you work with at Microsoft. If you have the browser bar, then you have much more information about which IP addresses are all the same user, right? So, but I was a bit I thought it was a really cool chance that we could now as an academic group, experiment live with real people on the web. And then now when I look back, you see all the complications of experimenting like that on the web. But Diane also gave a lecture, so you know what is the right thing to do, right? But this, this online evaluation with a platform where you can plug in your algorithm and then your recommendations go live, so you can do A/B testing. It will not teach you that much at the moment, I think. No, you only hear back when your recommendation was used. So, but you can trigger that, I think. Or you can play with it internally, because you can keep track of how many times was it. But you don't know when it was shown, because you only know that it was given to the newspaper.
That's tricky. I mean, in setting up an A/B test, you have to make sure that there's no correlates with your
So if you're really interested in that type of work, then you could consider using the ORP, but you can also apply with Katja for an internship, and then you have much better resources to
Let me just make a comment for
yeah.
the students linking with the session on Monday. On Monday, we were talking about how important it is to choose the right metric, because it's a way of really understanding the problem that you are trying to solve. And Arjen has given a wonderful example of what can happen if you take this metric wrong. And in this recommendation problem, they choose a metric looking at the output of the system that is not close enough and how it's going to be used for the users. And so the metric like assumes that the user will get all the grid of all potential rankings that he would do for the movies. And that's not the case. What you want to give the user is just a small bunch of recommendations. And by choosing the wrong metric, the problem is that scientists are very creative when it comes to proposing new ideas, but they are very conservative with methodology, and that's for a reason. So if you choose the wrong metric at the beginning, it's extremely difficult to drive the community into a new thing. And it's shocking that the example that really they are getting to conclusions on what are the most appropriate algorithms that seem to be plainly wrong.
For that task. But then if you talk to them about it, they will say like, yeah, but internally it does show that it learns much better the function. So from the machine learning perspective of learning a function well, they do better. So they just forgot that there was also an application with the user.
They do the wrong system right.
Yeah. And we do the right system wrong. Yeah. Yes. Yes, I think it's very important, and I think also, so if you then go back to normal information retrieval, we would like more of those features somehow. But again, the problem of evaluation is eminent then, because it is much harder to evaluate if the explanation was good, because you first need to find that that the answer was good, and then the user has to tell you something about does this explanation of why this answer was retrieved really help me or not. So, but it is an open area, and I know that there are a few people in, for example, UMAP community working on that problem. And I think it's very important that we get a better grip of it.
And the last question. Do you want Stefan to ask anything?
I can ask another one if you want. You mentioned the star, the 5-star, the distance. I mean, the important thing is the 5-star.
Yeah.
So do you mean that it is better to have just one result with 5 stars than n results with 4 stars, usually in this task?
Oh.
Or if you have a certain amount with 4 stars, then you will overcome. So what you are really meaning is that the distance between 5 and 4 is a bigger distance than the distance between 1 and 0. Because this is exactly
yeah.
the alpha top heaviness assumptions I've been discussing at the end of my lecture. So which of the two?
Yeah.
Okay.
It also depends a lot per user.
Okay.
So if you look at, because that's another thing I didn't talk about, but if you look at rating distributions, that depends a lot. So some users are very rarely giving a 5.
Okay.
And they are all around a 3-star, 4-star. There are many users that never give negative ratings. Probably because they were already bothered. They were already fed up with it, so they don't want to spend more time on it. Something like that. And there are also users where there is an equal spread. But I think you also have that with reviewing for conferences. You know, some users say very good or very bad. And others say always, yeah, weak accept. And then as the chair, you look at all the weak accepts, so you think like, what do I do? So it depends. So you would need it, something like that, but then also personalized. And I think what you're hinting at, you should also talk to Live, or Live will probably automatically come to talk to you. Because it is very related to the utility side of things, right? So you are asking, like, is the utility of finding five inferior results, but at least you have five reasonably good things, is that utility better than having the one good thing that you wanted? And I think it is a matter of opinion in a way. So there's no absolute answer.